Good morning.
Good morning.
See you all again. I'll start off with a reading from Luke chapter 6. You probably all know this one. But it says, "But I say to you here, love your enemies, do good to those who hate you, bless those who curse you, pray for those who abuse you. To the one who strikes you on the cheek, offer the other also. And from one who takes your cloak, do not withhold your tunic either. Give everyone who begs from you, and give to everyone who begs from you, and from one who takes away your goods, do not demand them back. And as you wish that others would do to you, do so to them. So who is my enemy? Is it the thief who stole the pegs off my clothesline? Is it the car salesman who sold me a van once that must have come across from Japan as deck cargo on a submarine? Or is it the drug addict who broke into my house and stole my television to resell and buy drugs? There was an article in the newspaper several years ago about a thief, and he stole a garden gnome from a home in Mayfield. And a poem went out in all the newspapers for this return of this precious gnome. And for several weeks there was no response. But then one day, in the mail, arrived with their gnome sitting on the handrail of Tower Bridge in London. A few days later, another photograph of him sitting on the beach at Brighton. And so it continued for the next 6 months. Week after week, their gnome was photographed all over Europe, having a wonderful time. One day, to their surprise, tired and worn out, their gnome was found back in his garden, covered in a little blanket with his head on a little pillow, obviously suffering from jet lag. I know exactly how he feels. But are these people really an enemy, or are they just some person having a bit of fun, or trying to make a living, or just fighting to survive in a world that has plunged them deep into depression and hopelessness? There was a slave in the West Indies called Caesar by his master. He had gained his freedom and also become a Christian. One day his lord took him to the slave market in search of some new slaves. After securing all he wanted, the owner was surprised to hear Caesar beg for the purchase of yet one more, an old, tired negro. "Why, Caesar, why should I buy him? Or what use can he possibly be? Please, sir," replied Caesar, "you must buy him for me." So the purchase was made, and the old man returned to the plantation, but soon he became very, very sick. And Caesar cared for him as though he were his father. He washed him, he waited on him, nursed him in every spare moment he found. And of course, all the people noticed this and tried to guess why Caesar was so devoted to the old man. Finally, his master asked, "What connection do you have with that old man? Is he perhaps your father?" Caesar simply smiled and said, "No, master, he's not my father." "Well, is he some old heathen friend or relative?" "No, master, he's no relative of mine." "He must be your friend then." "No, master, he's not my friend." "But who in the world is he?" asked the master impatiently. Caesar's eyes moistened as he said, "While yet a child, he tore me from my parents' arms and sold me as a slave. He is my enemy. But I must love my enemy, master, I must." Are these the people that Jesus is talking about when he asks us to love and forgive them? And are they really our enemy? The word enemy has a sinister definition. It means someone who cherishes hatred or harmful designs against another, an adversary, an opponent, a hostile state or a nation. So I guess a known thief can't really fit into this definition. You know, I've always loved engineering. The mighty structures like the Firth of Forth Rail Bridge or the Sydney Harbour Bridge. to the intricate gears in the wheels and the mechanisms of a Swiss watch. And I marvel at the concepts brought about or brought into practical fruition by ordinary men and women who have an idea or a vision. You know, in the Rolls-Royce factory at Derby is a stained glass window that depicts a young pilot as a memorial to the brave young pilots of World War II. The inscription reads, "To the pilots of the Royal Air Force, who in the Battle of Britain turned the work of our hands into the salvation of our country." The engineers and tradesmen of Rolls-Royce designed and produced the Merlin engine to defend England, her Christian civilization, and to defeat her enemy. The Merlin was used in Spitfires and Hurricanes and Halifaxes and Wellingtons, Defiance, Mustangs and Mosquitoes. And Jeremy Clark said the following, he said, "The fact is simple." He said, "The Spitfire looked good. It was every bit as dashing as the young men who flew it. And in flight, it was graceful as any bird. Its progress through the sky seemed effortless, as though it was just simply riding the breeze. And the Merlin engine was only there to provide a suitable soundtrack." Possibly, just possibly, the Spitfire is the greatest machine ever made. But can we clearly see how Adam is? You know, when World War I broke out, the War Ministry in London dispatched a coded message to one of the British outposts in an inaccessible area of Africa. The message read, "War declared, arrest all enemy aliens in your district." The War Ministry received a prompt reply, "Have arrested 10 Germans, 6 Belgians, 4 Frenchmen, 2 Italians, 3 Austrians and Americans. Please advise immediately who we are at war with." But it was much clearer in 1939. Winston Churchill knew exactly who his enemy was. He said, "I have only one purpose." He said, "The destruction of Hitler, and my life is much simplified thereby." He said, "If Hitler invaded hell, I would make at least a favourable reference to the devil in the House of Commons." In 1941, Stalin was not too sure who his enemy was. You see, he'd made a deal with the enemy. He'd made a deal with Hitler. But the German line of battle was drawn up along the whole frontier from the Baltic to the Black Sea. The Northern Army Group, with 29 divisions, was to advance on Leningrad. The Central Army Group, consisting of 50 divisions, was to move on Smolensk. The Southern Army Group of 40 divisions to drive into the lower Danube. A further 26 divisions were shortly to be available as the General Reserve, and on and on and on. They had 2,700 aircraft supporting the attack. All in all, 164 divisions were about to roll eastward. And at 4 a.m. on the 23rd of June in 1941, they did just that. All told, approximately 2 million soldiers invaded Russia. The strange thing is that Stalin had a feeling that Hitler was going to invade, but he thought he had another 6 months up his sleeve. You know, you can never underestimate your enemy. But who's our real enemy? Who really is he? There's a story of a lady who never spoke ill of anyone. "I believe you would even say something good about the devil," a friend told her. "Well," she said, "you certainly do have to admire his persistence." But he's called the dragon, the old serpent, the prince of this world, the prince of the power of the air, the god of this world, the spirit that now works in the children of disobedience. The distinct personality of Satan and his activity among men are thus obviously recognised. He tempted our Lord in the wilderness. He is Beelzebub, the prince of the devils. He is the constant enemy of God, of Christ, of the divine kingdom, of the followers of Christ, of all truth, full of falsehood and all malice, and exciting and seducing to evil, the in every possible way. His power is very great in the world. He is a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. Men are said to be taken captive by him. Christians are warned against his devices and called on to resist him. Christ redeems his people from him that had the power of death, that is, the devil. Satan has the power of death, not as Lord, but simply as executioner. It is so easy to recognize our enemy. C.H. Spurgeon, he said this, "A garrison is not free from danger while it has an enemy lodged within. You may bolt all your doors and fasten all your windows, but if thieves have placed even a little child within doors, who can draw the bolts and open the doors for them, the house is still unprotected. All the sea outside the ship cannot do it damage till the water enters within and fills the hole. Hence, it is clear our greatest danger is from within. All the demons in hell and tempers on earth could do us no injury if there were no corruption in our natures. The sparks will fall harmlessly if there is no tinder. Alas, our hearts are our greatest enemies. They are the little home of born thieves. Lord, save me from that man, that evil man, myself." The destruction of the church, the bride of Christ, has always been the main goal for Satan. The church will continue to be persecuted as long as Satan exercises his powers on earth. When Adolf Hitler began his conquest of the world, he quickly recognized that there was one formidable power which stood between him and his goal of controlling the government, the confessing church, and the men who were spiritual descendants of Martin Luther. To neutralize the criticism of the church, Hitler spoke of himself as a believer and sought to win the church's support for a white paper, a position paper outlining the supremacy of the Aryan or white race, denouncing Jews as inferiors. Few men, however, would compromise. Hitler knew they had to be destroyed, and thousands of German pastors were among those sent to the concentration camps, including an outspoken German minister by the name of Dietrich Bonhoeffer. In prison, Bonhoeffer had time to reflect on the true nature of the gospel and what it costs to be a Christian. Out of that experience came Bonhoeffer's book, The Cost of Discipleship. In the Soviet Union, over 4,000 priests, pastors and ministers from all denominations gathered in the Soviet Union and elected Joseph Stalin as their honorary president. One by one, the conferees went to the podium and declared that Christianity and communism were fundamentally the same. They could get along. One young woman could not bear what she was hearing and begged her husband to go forth and wash the shame off the face of Jesus. Her husband was Richard Wurmbrand. "If I speak against communism, you will no longer have a husband," he said. His wife replied, "I do not wish to have a cow as a husband." Pastor Wurmbrand went to the podium and spoke of loyalty only to Jesus. He said, "Christianity could not coexist with any entity that opposes the Great Commission of the Lord Jesus Christ." Wurmbrand paid dearly for his stand. He spent years in communist jails, being beaten and abused. Wurmbrand went on to write books about his experience and founded the organization Voice of the Martyrs. His message encourages many today. Christians are not to hate those who oppose them. We are to stand against deception and advocate love and truth. Believers in Jesus need to seek peace, but never traded for compromise. I'll ask again, do we know our enemy? In 1 Corinthians, it says this, "For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ all shall be made alive, but each one in his own order. Christ the first fruit, spirits, afterwards those who are Christ's at his coming. Then comes the end, when he delivers the kingdom to God the Father, when he puts an end to all rule and authority and power. For he must reign till he has put all enemies under his feet. The last enemy that will be destroyed is death. The last enemy, death, shall be destroyed, shall be counterworked, subverted, and finally overturned. But death cannot be destroyed by there being simply no further death. Death can only be destroyed and annihilated by a general resurrection. If there be no general resurrection, it is most evident that death will remain, and Satan will retain his empire. Therefore, the fact that death shall be destroyed ensures the fact that there shall be a general resurrection, and this is also proof that after the resurrection, there shall be no more death. This is a brief summary of Revelation chapter 12. John now sees visions that are clearly symbolic in nature. A pregnant woman is pursued by an enormous red dragon. The woman gives birth to a son destined to rule the nations with an iron scepter, a clear reference to the Messiah. After God snatches the child up to heaven, the woman flees into the desert to hide for 1,260 days. God also sees war in heaven with the great dragon. Satan hurls to the earth with his followers. His triumph is celebrated by a voice in heaven. This triumph is celebrated by a voice in heaven, which also depicts Satan's fury. In frustration, Satan pursues the woman who had given birth to the child and also makes war on all the saints. That's you and us. But this chapter, I have discovered, has many interpretations. Some see it as the nation of Israel John is talking about, while others see it as the church that is a humble veteran machinist. I'll leave those interpretations up to the experts. But as I read it, I got a sense of a battle that still rages on. Revelation chapter 12. And a great sign appeared in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun, with the moon under her feet, and on her head a crown of 12 stars. She was pregnant and crying out in birth pains and the agony of giving birth. And another sign appeared in heaven, behold, a great red dragon with 7 heads and 10 horns, and on each of his heads 7 diadems. His tail swept down a third of the stars of heaven and cast them to the earth, and the dragon stood before the woman who was about to give birth, so that when she bore her child, he might devour it. She gave birth to a male child, one who is to rule all nations with a rod of iron, but her child was caught up to God, to his throne. And the woman fled into the wilderness, where she has a place prepared by God, in which she is to be nourished for 1,260 days. Now war arose in heaven, Michael and his angels fighting against the dragon, and the dragon and his angels fought back, but he was defeated, and there was no longer any place for them in heaven. And the great dragon was thrown down, that ancient serpent, who was called the devil and Satan, the deceiver of the whole world. He was thrown down to the earth, and his angels were thrown down with him. And I heard a loud voice in heaven saying, now the salvation and the power of the kingdom of our God and the authority of Christ have come. For the accuser of our brothers has been thrown down, who accuses them day and night before our God. And they have conquered him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, for they loved not their lives even unto death. Therefore rejoice, O heavens, and you who dwell in them, but woe to you, O earth and sea, for the devil has come down to you in great wrath, because he knows that his time is short. And when the dragon saw that he had been thrown down to the earth, he pursued the woman who had given birth to the male child. But the woman was given 2 wings, a great eagle, so she might be able to fly from the serpent into the wilderness, into a place where she is to be nourished for a time and times and half a time. The serpent poured forth water like a river out of his mouth after the woman to sweep her away with the flood. But the earth came and helped the woman. And the earth opened its mouth and swallowed the river that the dragon had poured from his mouth. Then the dragon became furious with the woman and went off to make war on the rest of her offspring, on those who keep the commandments of God and hold the testimony of Jesus Christ. That's us. The church is Satan's target, and we are the church. And you wonder what possible defence we have against such a savage and unrelenting enemy. Well, that's easy. And you know this one probably off by heart, Ephesians chapter 6. It says, "Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armour of God, that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore take unto you the whole armour of God, that ye may be able to withstand on the evil day, and having done all, to stand. Stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, and having on your breastplate, on the breastplate of righteousness, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith you shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, praying always with all prayer and supplication to the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for the saints." What our danger is, and what we need to have to put on this whole armour, considering what sort of enemies we have to deal with, the devil and all the powers of darkness. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but the combat for which we are to be prepared is not against ordinary enemies, not merely against men compounded of flesh and blood, nor against our own corrupt natures, singly considered, but against the several ranks of devils who have a government which they exercise in this world. We have to do with a subtle enemy, an enemy who uses wiles and stratagems. He has a thousand ways of beguiling unstable souls. Hence he is called a serpent for subtlety, an old serpent experienced in the art of trade and tempting. So I'd like to finish off with this little thing I found from Isaac Watts. It says, "Am I a soldier of the cross, a follower of the Lamb? And shall I fear to own his cause or blush to speak his name? Must I be carried to the skies on flowery beds of ease, while others fought to win the prize and sail through bloody seas? Are there no foes for me to face? Must I not stem the flood? Is this vile world a friend to grace to help me on to God? Sure, I must fight if I would reign. Increase my courage, Lord. I'll bear the toil, endure the pain, supported by thy word. Thy saints, in all this glorious war, shall conquer though they die. They see the triumph from afar by faith's discerning eye. When that illustrious day shall rise, when all thy armies shine in robes of victory through the skies, the glory shall be thine." You know, God never makes us conscious of our weakness, except to give us with his strength. In closing prayer, Father God, encourage us and equip us to face Satan, our enemy, and all his deceiving and treacherous ways. Protect us as we defy Satan's attempt to enter our lives, and give us the courage and the perseverance to see his struggle through to victory with you by our side. Amen. By the way,